Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Manjula Sharma from University of Delhi. Today we are going to discuss about the module Raman spectroscopy from the paper Physics at Nanoscales. So students, let us discuss what we are going to learn in this module. First, the vibrations in a single atom, diatomic molecule, linear and non-linear triatomic molecule. The Raman spectroscopy, its basic principles, active Raman vibrations. Third, the energy transfer model. Fourth, the classical treatment of Raman scattering. And fifth, why is Raman spectroscopy called a local probe? So students, Raman spectroscopy is a molecular spectroscopy which is observed as inelastically scattered light. It allows for the interrogation and identification of vibrational, that is the phonon states of molecules. As a result, the Raman spectroscopy provides an invaluable analytical tool for molecular fingerprinting as well as monitoring changes in molecular bond structure, that is state changes, the stress and the strains. In comparison to other vibrational spectroscopy methods, such as FTIR and NIR, Raman has several major advantages. These advantages stem from the fact that Raman effect manifests itself in the light scattered off the sample as opposed to the light absorbed by the sample. As a result, Raman spectroscopy requires little to no sample preparation and is insensitive to aqueous absorption bands. This property of Raman facilitates the measurement of solids, liquids and gases not only directly but also through transparent containers such as glass, quartz and plastic. So students, first we should consider the degrees of freedom for the different molecules or the materials which we face in our day-to-day life. First, let us consider the case of single atom. The vibrations, like the atoms of a molecule changing their relative positions without changing the position of the molecular center of mass, is known as the vibration. For the case of a single atom, there are no vibrations, that is, it takes two to vibrate. A single atom do not possess rotation as well. It can only translate in x, y or z direction, as is shown in the figure. Thus, a single atom has 3 degrees of freedom and 0 vibrations. Let us consider the case of a diatomic molecule. A diatomic molecule can have 6 degrees of freedom, as it has 2 atoms and each atom will have 3 degrees of freedom. That is, translation. It can translate in 3 directions, that is x axis, y axis or along the z axis. The diatomic molecule can also possess rotation along its axis of rotation, which is perpendicular to the line connecting the 2 atoms. That is, it can have rotation in the x along the x axis or along the y axis, while it cannot possess rotation along the z axis. Thus, it will have 3 translations and 2 rotations. Also, it can vibrate along its axis, which is stretching and compressing. Thus, it will have 1 vibration as well. That is, for a linear molecule, the number of vibrations will be equal to 3n-5. Let us consider the case of a linear triatomic molecule. A triatomic molecule has 3 atoms and it can have 3 degrees of freedom each. So that is, it will have in total 9 degrees of freedom, which are divided as 3 translation, 2 rotation and 4 vibration. 3 translation degrees of freedom are along the x-axis, the y-axis and the z-axis. The 2 rotations will be similar to what it was for the diatomic molecule. For a linear molecule, the number of vibrations are given by 3n minus 5. That is, it will have 4 vibrations. Let us consider the case of a linear triatomic molecule, that is carbon dioxide, which is CO2. The carbon molecule is present in the center and the two oxygen molecules are present on the each side of carbon. Thus, it can have a symmetric stretch, a bending where carbon goes in one direction and both the oxygen go in the other direction. It can have asymmetric, antisymmetric stretch as well, where one carbon and oxygen go in one direction while other oxygen goes in the different direction. Thus, the 9 degrees of freedom are shown. Now, let us consider the case of a nonlinear triatomic molecule. In this, there can be three kinds of translation, that is along x-axis, the y-axis and the z-axis. And there can be three kinds of rotation as well. One is along the up-down direction, one is along the backward and forward direction, one the left-right and one the yaw direction, as is shown in the figure. For the case of a nonlinear triatomic molecule, there can be translation along the z direction, the translation along the y direction, the translation along the z direction, as is shown in the figure. Also, there can be rotation about the z axis, which is shown by rz, the rotation about the x axis, which is shown by rx, the rotation about the y axis, which is shown by ry. Thus, there can be 9 degrees of freedom, 3 translational, 3 rotational and 3 vibrational. For a nonlinear molecule, the number of vibrations is given by 3n minus 6. Students, now let us consider the molecular vibrations. These correspond to the atoms of a molecule changing their relative positions without changing the position of the molecular center of mass, even at absolute zero. In terms of a molecular geometry, these vibrations amount to continuously changing bond lengths and bond angles. The center of mass of a molecule is given by xCm is equal to m1x1 plus m2x2 divided by m1 plus m2, where m1 and m2 are the masses of the two atoms which constitute the molecule. The reduced mass of the molecule is given by mu is equal to m1 m2 divided by m1 plus m2, driven by or governed by the Hooke's law, that is, the change in energy is equal to half kx square, where k is the force constant, x is the distance. The assumption it assumes is it takes the same energy to stretch the bond as it takes to compress the bond. The bond length can be considered to be infinite as well. The figure shows a two molecule system where the distance in between the two atoms is given by R. The first figure shows the compression, where the compression is by a factor of x, which is the distance in the Hooke's law, and the third figure shows the expansion by x, which is the distance in the Hooke's law. Let us see the vibration frequency nu. It is related to the stiffness of the bond, which is present in between the two atoms in the molecule. The atomic mass is given by mu, which is the reduced mass of the system. Thus, the vibration frequency is given by nu equal to 1 by 2 pi square root of k by mu. So, let us see what Raman spectroscopy is. Raman spectroscopy is a complementary technique to IR spectroscopy, that is the infrared spectroscopy. It consists of a radiation at a certain frequency which is scattered by the molecule with shift in the wavelength of the incident beam. The observed frequency shift are related to the vibrational changes in the molecule. It is also associated with the IR absorbance. Raman scattering spectrum resembles IR absorbance spectrum. However, the Raman and IR mechanisms are different. Let us see the comparison in between the Raman and IR. The IR spectrum consists of the vibrational modes. However, Raman corresponds to the vibrational modes. IR consists of the change in dipole moment of the molecule, while the Raman corresponds to the change in the polarizability of the molecule. For IR, there is an excitation of molecule to excited vibrational state. However, in Raman, there is a momentary distortion of the electrons distributed around the bond. For IR, there is asymmetric vibrations which are active, while for Raman, the symmetric vibrations are active. Students, let us see the basic principles of Raman spectroscopy. In this, light is scattered by the sample at various angles by momentary absorption to a virtual state and re-emission. In the process, some scattered emissions occur at the same energy while others return in a different state. Let us see the Mantle diagram as shown in the figure. The sample absorbs the photons incident on it and the material goes into the excited state from the ground excited state to the virtual states. Then after the momentary absorption, the virtual state leads to the re-emission of photons. In the process, there will be emission of energy having energy either less than the absorbed energy or greater than the absorbed energy. That is called as Raman scattering. That is, it involves a net change in the energy. That is, h nu in is not equal to h nu out, where h nu in is the absorbed energy while h nu out is the emitted energy. Nu in is the wave number of the absorbed photons and nu out is the wave number of the emitted photons. If h nu in is equal to h nu out, that is, the emitted photons have the same energy as the absorbed photons, then it is called as Rayleigh scattering and it does not involve any change in energy. The elastic collision between the photon and the molecule results in no change in energy, while a inelastic collision between the molecule and the photons results in a net change in energy. There can be two types of Raman scattering, anti-Stokes and Stokes. Anti-Stokes lines correspond to the emitted energy having higher energy than that of the absorbed photons, while the Stokes line corresponds to the emitted energy having energy less than that of the absorbed photons. That is, the anti-Stokes line can be written as E is equal to h nu plus delta E, while the Stokes lines can be written as h nu minus delta E. The delta E, either positive or negative, corresponds to the energy of the first vibration level of the ground state, that is, the IR vibration absorbance. The Raman frequency shift and IR absorption peak frequency are identical. Let us consider the case of Stokes and anti-Stokes lines. In the figure, as it is shown, for the Stokes lines, the energy is absorbed from a lower energy level, represented by nu equal to zero, to the excited state, represented by J. Then the emitted energy is corresponding to the energy level from J to the energy level corresponding to nu equal to 1. That is, now the energy of the emitted radiation is less than that of the absorbed radiation. In the case of anti-Stokes lines, the absorbed energy corresponds to the energy levels from nu equal to 1 to the J state, while the emitted energy corresponds to the levels from J equal to nu equal to 0. That is, the emitted radiation has energy equal to H multiplied by nu excitation plus nu, the nu. This is the difference in between the Stokes and anti-Stokes lines. That is, Stokes lines correspond to lower energy, while the anti-Stokes lines correspond to higher energy. The Rayleigh scattering has highest intensity, the Stokes have less than that, and anti-Stokes have the lowest intensity, as observed in the experiments. The intensity of Raman lines are 0.001% of the intensity of the source. That is, the Raman spectrum have very low intensity. Let us see the active Raman vibrations. These need change in the polarizability of molecule during vibration. The polarizability is related to electron cloud distribution. Let us consider the example of carbon dioxide, which is CO2 and is a linear molecule. It is IR inactive while it is Raman active. IR and Raman are complementary. It can be the case where vibration is both IR and Raman active. For example, SO2, which is a nonlinear molecule. In general, IR tends to emphasize polar functional groups, that is ROH, while Raman emphasizes aromatic and carbon backbone, that is CC, CH2, etc. Raman does not see many common polar solvents. It can also be used with aqueous samples, which is an advantage over IR. The Raman frequency range is from 4000 to 50 per centimeter, including both Stokes and anti-Stokes. The figure shows the comparison of Raman and IR spectra for two molecules, that is mesityline and indene. As we can see, both Raman and IR are complementary to each other. Now students, let us consider the connection in between the vibrations and phonons. In the figure is shown a material having molecules. The vibrations present in the molecular system can be connected with a present in the material, which is given by a wave vector K. A represents the lattice parameter or the distance in between the two adjacent molecules. Lambda is giving the wavelength of the vibrational wave. This vibrational wave can be described by a quasi-particle, which is known as a phonon. This is in analogy with a photon for an electromagnetic wave. The frequency of these phonons is related or is dependent upon the wave vector K. That is, omega is a function of wave vector K, and it is known as the phonon dispersion. Now, let us see the phonons and Raman spectroscopy. For the optical photons,
they have small wave vector and they follow wave vector conservation as well. For the Raman phonons, the momentum transfer is very small. The dispersion curve of the phonons can be divided into two branches, that is the acoustical branch and the optical branch. K equal to pi by a is known as the zone boundary. K equal to 0 is known as the zone center, and it corresponds to a infinite wavelength. The optical branch corresponds to a phase in which all the unit cells are vibrating in phase. While the K equal to pi by a, the zone boundary corresponds to all unit cells which vibrate in antiphase, as is shown in the figure. What is Raman effect? It is basically the inelastic scattering of light with a material. The figure shows that incident light of wave vector ki is falls on the sample, and the scattered light may consist of either Raman scattering or the phonons, the magnons, etc. The figure shows the example of a Raman spectrum. It consists of the Raman scattering Stokes lines, the Raman scattering anti-Stokes lines, and the Rayleigh scattering. The unit of the Raman scattering which the spectroscopists use is the wave number, which is denoted by centimeter inverse. That is, nu bar is equal to 1 by lambda is equal to nu by c. The conversions are given as 1 MeV is equal to 8.051 per centimeter. 1 terahertz is equal to 33 per centimeter. 1 terahertz is equal to 4.136 MeV. Here is shown the energy transfer model. For the Rayleigh scattering, that is the elastic scattering, the absorbed light corresponds to the energy level difference of the fundamental electronic state to the virtual state, which is represented by nu naught. The emitted energy also corresponds to the same energy level differences, that is in between the virtual state and the fundamental electronic state. So the absorbed and the emitted radiation both have the same energy wave vector, which is given by nu naught. For the Stokes scattering, nu naught energy is absorbed, while the emitted energy corresponds to nu naught minus nu vibrational. For anti-Stokes scattering, the emitted radiation corresponds to nu naught plus nu vibrational, and thus the anti-Stokes lines have higher wave number than the Stokes lines. The optical mode corresponds to Raman scattering. The acoustic mode corresponds to the Brillouin scattering. In principle, we can also study the rotational states, magnetic states, which is magnons, electronic states, polarons, magnetoelectronic states, electromagnons, etc. Let us consider the classical treatment of the Raman scattering. The source of the scattered light can be either Rayleigh or Raman. These are the induced dipole of the molecule by the incident electric field. The laser energy is given by, or the electromagnetic field E is given by E equal to E naught cos omega naught t. For the molecule, the vibration or the x, the distance in between the two molecules or atoms, is given by x is equal to x naught cos omega m t. Then the induced electric dipole moment will be given by mu is equal to alpha e plus half beta e e plus 1 by 6 gamma e e e plus so on. The first term corresponds to the Raman scattering, while the second, third terms correspond to hyper Raman scattering, where alpha is the polarizability tensor, beta is the hyperpolarizability tensor, gamma is the second hyperpolarizability tensor. Alpha is far greater than beta, which in turn is far greater than gamma. Thus, mu is approximately equal to alpha E, which is a limitation to linear effects. Continuing the classical treatment, that is the induced dipole, mu is approximately equal to alpha E, which can be expanded by Taylor approximation around x naught. So alpha x is given by alpha naught plus del alpha by del x at x naught into x plus so on. Thus the induced electric dipole is given by mu is equal to alpha naught plus del alpha by del x at x naught into x whole multiplied by E. Thus the incident field E is equal to E naught cos omega naught t is in turn is equal to, which implies mu is equal to alpha naught plus del alpha by del x at x naught into x whole multiplied by E naught cos omega naught t. The eigen vibration of the molecule is given by x is equal to x naught cos omega mt. Putting this into the above equation gives us the induced electric dipole equal to alpha naught E naught cos omega naught t plus del alpha del x at x naught E naught cos omega naught t x naught cos omega mt. Now, finally, the result of the classical treatment. The induced electric dipole moment is given as alpha naught E naught cos omega naught t plus half del alpha by del x at x naught multiplied by E naught x multiplied by cos omega naught plus omega m whole t plus cos omega naught minus omega m into t. So finally, in short, it can be written as mu is equal to mu as a function of omega naught plus mu as a function of omega naught plus omega m plus mu as a function of omega naught minus omega m. The Raman scattering results from a modulation of incident electric field by the vibrating molecule, which leads to two new frequencies, omega naught plus omega m and omega naught minus omega m. In the classical treatment, the Raman activity is ruled by a selection rule. So we know that mu is equal to alpha naught E naught cos omega naught t plus half del alpha by del x at x naught E naught x multiplied by cos omega naught plus omega m into t plus cos omega naught minus omega m into t. A mode is only active in Raman spectroscopy if del alpha by del x at x naught is not equal to 0, which is the selection rule for a mode to be active. So students, let us see the illustration of the Raman activity and symmetry. There can be two types of modes, the symmetric mode and the asymmetric mode, as shown in the figure. If del alpha by del x at x naught is not equal to 0, then it is Raman active. However, if del alpha by del x at x naught is equal to 0, then it is Raman inactive. If del mu by del x at x naught is not equal to 0, then it is IR active. While if del mu by del x at x naught is equal to 0, then it is IR inactive. Thus we see that the Raman and IR spectroscopy are complementary. The exclusion rule is, in a centrosymmetric molecule or crystal, none of the Raman active modes is IR active and vice versa. The change in the molecular dipole moment when the atoms vibrate determines whether the vibration is or is not IR active. So why Raman spectroscopy is a local probe? It is a zone center process, that is, all unit cells vibrate in phase. It consists of the summation of signal, that is, the spectrum is equal to the summation of all the scattered photons. So it is useful for the twins and for the disorder measurements. The scattering volume in the Raman spectroscopy is some 10 unit cells. That is, it is useful for thin films and also for the detection of impurities. It has short coherence length, that is some unit cells, and hence it is very much useful for the amorphous materials. The special resolution of the Raman spectroscopy is 1 microns under the microscope. Thus, it is useful for the devices and for the grain size. Now, let us see a very important example of the use of Raman spectroscopy in the case of a 2D material, which is graphene in the present case. Raman spectroscopy is highly useful for the identification of single atomic layers of graphene. As can be seen in the figure, that for a 1 layer, 2 layer, 5 layer and 10 layers, there is a very clear shift in the Raman spectroscopy lines. And by using this shift, one can identify the presence of one monolayer or bilayer or a bulk material present in the system. The left hand side shows the optical and the AFM images of the graphenes which were produced in the lab.
So students, let us summarize what we have learnt in this module. We have learnt the vibrations in a single atom, the diatomic molecule, the linear and non-linear triatomic molecule. We studied their degrees of freedom. In the single atom, it was 3 degrees of freedom. For diatomic molecule, it had 6 degrees of freedom. For a triatomic molecule, there were 9 degrees of freedom. We also learnt the Raman spectroscopy, its basic principles, the active Raman vibrations as well. We also studied the Stokes and the anti-Stokes lines. We saw that the Stokes lines have lower frequency than the anti-Stokes lines. That is, the energy of anti-Stokes lines is higher than that of the Stokes lines. We also saw the intensity of the Stokes lines is higher than that of the anti-Stokes lines. The total intensity of the Raman spectrum or the emitted Raman scattered light is only 0.001% of the incident beam. We also studied the energy transfer model. In this, we saw that we had Rayleigh scattering, we had anti-Stokes scattering and also the Stokes scattering. We also studied the classical treatment of the Raman scattering. At the end, we studied why Raman spectroscopy is considered as a local probe. We saw that by using Raman spectroscopy on a 2D material like a graphite, a 2D material of graphite, that is graphene, we saw that just by seeing the position of the Raman scattering, we can define if it is a 2D layer, that is 1 monolayer, 2 monolayer, 5 monolayer, or it is a bulk material. We also saw that the Raman spectroscopy is very much surface sensitive. It takes care only of the initial 10 unit cells present in the material and gives us information of the material. Thus, Raman spectroscopy is a very useful probe for the experimentalists. Thank you.